Oh. I will, yeah. It is time.
We are really practicing social distancing.
Yeah, it's really, really like miles and miles and miles.
They haven't used that quite now.
Since I went.
I can barely see. It's like a few minutes after 9 now.
It's 3 after, yes.
Well, snow overnight. Those of you who are praying for snow, you did a good job, because they originally said we'd have 1 to 2 inches, and we woke up to, at least in my house, 6 inches, and I think everybody was surprised about that amount, because when I got to Carlton, there was this little issue of snow on the roads and the parking lots, and so there's not a lot of us in church, because I think most of you are dealing with snow. But that's okay, because it's a good thing. We know we need snow, especially this time of the year. If we don't get it, then we have problems with septic tanks and water lines freezing, and our snow industry in the winter needs snow to survive. So we need to be thankful for what we get, and that we are. It was absolutely gorgeous this morning. So we will start now. Are there any announcements that we need to do? This time, no? Okay. We will start with our first song then, which is I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light, 8:15.
God sent the stars to give light to the world. The
That we are not awake for you.
We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are affected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbors. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
With you.
Let us pray. Righteous God, our merciful Master, you own the earth and all its peoples, and you give us all that we have. Inspire us to serve you with justice and wisdom, and prepare for us the joy of the day of your coming, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We will now have the readings.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Though we do not know and cannot calculate the day of Christ's return, we live faithfully in the here and now as we anticipate the day when we will be given eternal salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come down upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in the darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief, but you are all children of the light and children of the day. We are not of the dark night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live within him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of Psalm 90, verses 1 through 12, we will read responsively by whole verse. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another.
For the mountains were brought forth, or the land on the earth were born. From age to age, you are God.
You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O children of earth.
For a thousand years in your sight are like yesterday, when it is past, and like a watch in the night.
You sweep them away like a dream. They fade away suddenly like the grass.
In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dried up and withered.
For we who are consumed by your anger, we are afraid because of your wrath.
Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance.
When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh.
The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labor and sorrow, for they pass away quickly and are gone.
Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation?
So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to do so.
Please stand for the gospel. The gospel today is from Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave five talents, to another two, to another one, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the five talents went off at once and traded with them and made five more talents. In the same way, the one who had the two talents made two more talents. But the one who had received the one talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the five talents came forward, bringing five more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me five talents. See, I have made five more talents.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of the master.' And the one with the two talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me two talents. See, I have made two more talents.' His master said to him, 'Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received one talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went, and I hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Here ends the gospel. Thanks be to God. You'll now have our hymn, Jesus, fill us with your love. And if you will stand while we sing, and then we'll sit for the sermon.
So he's taking pictures of the scenery around these world-famous monuments like the Taj Mahal in India, the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, the Eiffel Tower in Paris, but he's ignoring the monuments themselves. He's published these pictures in a book titled Volte Faccia, or in English, About Face. We use the term about face to refer to someone who experiences a complete change in attitude or opinion. Think about Oliver Curtis's project for a moment. This photographer is in the presence of a well-known monument, but he wants to gain a new perspective, a perspective gained by focusing on the setting. And as a consequence, he sees things most people never notice. How often do you stop and question why you notice the things that catch your attention? Generally, we follow the crowd, we fit in with our peers and our cultural expectations. We rarely question our priorities or our choices. What would it take for you to make a complete about-face, a reversal in your choices, your ideas, or priorities? What if you could see your life from God's perspective? That's the question I keep coming back to as I think about our lesson from Matthew's Gospel today. This passage is about a man who went on a journey and trusted his wealth to his servants. The man obviously represents God. We are the servants. And the wealth, well, we'll get to that in a minute. But there are two key words here that we have to confront if we're going to understand this story and apply it to our lives. The two words are entrusted and afraid. You see the word entrusted at least three times in these verses. The man entrusted his wealth to his three servants. He presented them with a big responsibility and a big opportunity. This man obviously had great faith in his servants. He saw great potential in them and great opportunities all around them. He saw that as God sees us, great potential and great opportunities fixed out in the world. Why else would the master have entrusted his wealth to them? The first and second servants invested the wealth of their master as he hoped that they would. When the master returned, they were presented him with a considerable profit on his money. The master praised their efforts, invited them to share his happiness. But the third servant hid his master's wealth and did nothing at all. Why? Because he was afraid. He was afraid of the master. He was afraid of the opportunity. He was afraid of the responsibility. And when the master returned, the third servant dug up the wealth and gave it back to the master. No return on the investment. Just one big lost opportunity. And the master condemned the servant for letting his fear override his responsibility. So that's the situation. Let's begin here. For me, the saddest and least productive emotion in life is fear. That's the first thing that strikes me in this passage. The saddest and least productive emotion is fear. It's the least fruitful emotion. Fear's only fruit is regret and lost opportunities and an increased focus on oneself and one's security. In the U.S. this past year, the coronavirus pandemic resulted in a new vocabulary for us. We created terms like social distancing and flatten the curve to describe activities to protect against the virus. It's been a worldwide phenomenon. I read that in Germany, a new word was created to describe hoarding of food and staple items brought about by this pandemic. The word is Hamsterkauf. The German word for hoarding is Hamstern, which comes from the image of hamsters storing up food in their cheeks. During the Cold War, the German government published a list of items that the average German household should have on hand in case of an emergency. Things like pasta and painkillers, of course, toilet paper. German citizens referred to this list as the Hamsterkauf list. The third servant was guilty of Hamsterkauf. He was afraid. He hoarded his master's money. Why? Because he didn't trust his master's character. Just like us, he had a few heartbreaks and setbacks in his life, and he no longer trusted the master's goodness or the master's priorities. So he decided to focus on his own security. Dig a hole in the ground, bury the wealth, and wait for the master to return. No risk, no responsibility, and no reward. Think of all the things in life you miss out on. We're afraid. We don't trust God's goodness and God's promises that He'll take care of it, that He'll give us His power and presence to make it through anything we're working through. Think of all the opportunities we could harvest with our God-given talents and opportunities if we were just bold enough to base our goals and priorities on God's promises instead of our own security. The saddest emotion and the least productive emotion in life is fear. We need to overcome our fear. And when we overcome our fear, we're going to have a fruitful life. Think how often the scriptures say, don't be afraid. Could it be that the opposite of faith is not unbelief, but fear? That command to live without fear isn't linked to some promise that nothing bad will ever happen to you. It's not linked to some promise that God is going to answer your every question and always work according to your expectations and your timeline. The command is linked, however, to the promise that God will be with you through every challenge. Let me tell you about a young woman who found help with her fear. On Palm Sunday, 1987, near the end of her church's worship service, this young woman suffered a horrifying brain aneurysm. The hospital doctors told the young woman that they could wait and watch the aneurysm and hope it didn't get much worse, or they could perform a very risky surgery to remove it. She chose to put her life in God's hands and have the surgery to remove it. The young woman experienced moments of overwhelming fear as she waited for the day the surgery would take place. One sleepless Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. She copied that verse down on a piece of a notepaper. She kept it with her all the time, read it every day until she had it memorized. Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. On the day of her surgery, she reluctantly handed the piece of paper with the Bible verse written on it over to the OR nurse. Nurse assured her that she would get the verse back after surgery. Many hours later, when the young woman woke from surgery, she found that that worn piece of paper with the verse from Joshua was taped to her palm. What a source of comfort it had become. Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Think how often the scriptures say, don't be afraid, or in this case, do not be terrified. Fear not only makes us miserable, but it robs us in so many ways, including possibly the ability for healing to take place in our bodies. Remember the example of the three servants? Two of the servants invested their master's property, which he yielded a tiny profit. The other man lost out because of his fear. This story from Matthew's Gospel tells us that Christ is looking for people with holy boldness. What is holy boldness? Boldness to let God direct your talents and energy toward good works that bring you glory. God made us to partner with him in ushering in the kingdom of God. Mind-blowing responsibility, mind-blowing opportunity. Notice that the outcome of this story rests on faith in God's character and obedience to God's commands. Both faith and obedience require the boldness to let go of your own security and comfort and let God use you for his larger plans. One last story. But a man named Robert Young, he was a successful businessman in Seattle, but on a business trip to Mexico, he noticed a newspaper headline that read like this: Elders Freeze to Death. The news article detailed the crushing poverty on local Native American reservations, the horrible living conditions of many elderly Native Americans. Robert couldn't explain why the news story grabbed at his heart, but it did. A few weeks later, Robert learned of an adoptive grandparent program for Native American elders. He called that number, signed up. Robert was paired with a 78-year-old Native American woman in South Dakota named Catherine Redfeather. Catherine welcomed Robert into her family as her newest grandchild. In spite of her poverty, her letters to him were full of joy, proudly sharing news of her large family. When Robert asked Catherine if there was anything he could send her, she asked only for a bottle of shampoo and some aspirin. Robert couldn't imagine living in such poverty that shampoo and aspirin were luxury items. He determined to visit Catherine Redfeather and see her living conditions for himself. So Robert and his wife Anita were shocked by the poverty they saw in Catherine's reservation, and he was humbled by the joy and love of Catherine. When he returned home, Robert couldn't find satisfaction in his work anymore. He worried all the time if his adopted grandmother was safe and warm and had all she needed. That summer, Robert, Anita, and a handful of friends traveled back to South Dakota to build a house for Catherine. As news of their project spread on the reservation, Catherine's family and friends showed up to help. And they had a big celebration when the home was complete. Now, Robert could relax and get back to his ambition and successful life, right? You know better than that. God had put a new vision in Robert Young's heart, and he couldn't bury his talent in self-interested pursuits. After a lot of research and thought, Robert Young sold his half of his successful business. He and Anita moved to Bozeman, Montana, and started the Red Feather Development Group to provide affordable, secure housing to Native Americans. Remember the two words that I said we had to confront in order to understand this Bible passage? Entrusted and afraid. God has entrusted you with great wealth. Your life, your talents, and energy, and intellect, and influence. And God can't use you for his glory works for God's glory. So now is the time to ask yourself, what do you want to hear at the end of your life? What will it take to hear God say, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things. I will then put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The Christian life, folks, is not for sissies. It's for people willing to live with holy boldness, seeking to be where God wants them to be, and living as God wants them to live. Do you see yourself in that role? Why settle for anything less? Something to think about as we continue our journey to the cross. Amen.
Longing for Christ's reign to come among us, we pray for the outpouring of God's power on the church, the world, and all in need. Lord of the Church, ignite your people with the passion of your love. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, unify us across ministries, congregations, and denominations, and refine us to participate in your activity throughout the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of creation, we stand in awe at the works of your hands and praise you for the beauty of nature. Definitely today for the beauty of the snow we have received. Bless the earth for your glory and restore its integrity where exploration has caused ruin. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the nations, sound forth your justice in the ears of all leaders. Increase concern for those who are most vulnerable, especially as international leaders forge trade agreements and cooperate to end human rights abuses. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of all in need, search all who cry to you in distress. Scatter the heavy clouds of depression, chronic illness, unemployment, and loneliness with your radiant light. Send us as encouragement and signs of your healing. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Lord of the strangers, stir up holy restlessness in us to extend love to those at the margins. Release our desire for control and open us to learn from the perspectives of others. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
And dear Lord, we would want you to be with Dorothy Galt's family as she has not survived the COVID. And her funeral was on Friday, and we know that you were with Dorothy. She was a great servant here on earth, and we ask for your loving arms to surround her family. Lord of the living and the dead, we give you thanks for all the saints at rest from their labors. Rouse us to live by their example, that saints yet to come may also know your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. Peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. When we gather for the celebration of Holy Communion, we hear again the story of God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, remember that in the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, gave it thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At this time, we will take our communion wafer. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, and shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." We are given as terms of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. Now that we have shared in the same bread of life and the same cup of blessing, you may be strengthened. As often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Now let us join together saying the prayer Jesus taught us, if you would stand while we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in this simple meal, you have set a banquet. Sustain us on the journey, strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen. We will now sing When Peace Like a River, number 785.
Whatever my love, thou hast taught.
serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.